Almighty God, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you for today. Thank you for another opportunity to minister to your children. Father, please let your Holy Spirit take over my thoughts and my utterances, so that the words I speak will not be my own, but coming from your mercy throne to touch souls and give them strength. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. The reality of life storms. Storms of life are real. Storms are life realities. What is a storm? A storm is a violent disturbance of the atmosphere with strong winds and usually rain, thunder, lightning, or snow. Whenever a settled or peaceful condition is interrupted, that is a disturbance. Storms have different names depending on the intensity, the nature, and the areas affected. So we have names like firestorm, when it has to do with fire, windstorm, hurricane, tornadoes, hailstorm, ice storm, snowstorm, thunderstorm, etc. Storms generally are very powerful and very destructive. Storms sometimes come very suddenly, while in some situations we get advance notices for us to take precautionary measures just to reduce the impact, not to eliminate it. It is a natural phenomenon, and so we surely come unless God decides otherwise. Nobody wants to experience any of the storms, but the truth still remains that storms will come when it will, and we need to be prepared always. Not everybody will experience physical storms, but definitely nobody is immune to or excluded from life storms, just like nobody is immune to a physical storm when it hits a particular area. I always marvel at the biblical story of the disciples and the storm in Mark 4, verses 35 to 41. In that story, Jesus Christ, the creator of heaven and earth, including the storm, in Jesus Christ, in whom all power and authority subsist, was in the boat with the disciples, and still the storm struck them. Storm is no respecter of persons. And this is one major lesson I want to pass on to you listening to me today. I'll talk more on it, but follow me to Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 27, where we have the parable of the wise and foolish builders, which will serve as our test. And I read, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." It crumbled. It collapsed. The above parable of Jesus Christ makes it very clear, absolutely clear, that storms will come and that it should be given adequate consideration in laying the foundation of any building. The nature or strength of the foundation will determine the overall impact of the storm on the building. Jesus Christ is simply saying that when we are bombarded by the storms of life, that it's only our relationship with Him that can give us victory. He never said that the storms will not come just because we are in Him. I need to stress this point because I have seen situations where some people have been driven to the edge or precipice of self-destruction by some nefarious, half-baked, and fraudulent men and women of God with their unethical, manipulative, hypnotic teachings on this subject of storms of life. Many homes, marriages, relationships have been destroyed, and the faith of many torn to pieces and blown away because of their teachings of bread and butter Christianity and conditional grace. Many have doubted the love of God for them. Like the unhelpful and unfriendly friends of Job, they have been made to feel too guilty to be forgiven by God. Hence, the storms in their lives. Yes, sometimes storms can be direct consequences of our sinful acts, but not so all the time. Let me take you to John 5, verse 1 to 14. About that man at the pool of Bethesda that had affliction for 38 years. After Jesus had healed him, he left that arena and were confronted by some people. Obviously, he may have started having doubt or whatever. But when Jesus met him again, he told him, "Young man, be careful. If you go back to sin, the affliction will come again." So in that circumstance, you can see that his sickness was a product of a sin. That makes a lot of sense. But when we go to John 9, verses 1 to 12, we see the story of that man born blind. And you know the Pharisees, those that believe they know God and understand Him, they said, yes, it must have been because of the sin of the forefathers. But Jesus said, no, this man has committed no sin. Neither did the father or forefathers, nobody. But it happened so that God's glory will be made manifest. Whatever storm that is hitting you, I want to tell you that God's glory will be made manifest in your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Who has never sinned? Does God not forgive sins again? Does God take delight in the death of a sinner? Not at all. So far as the sinner repents. Why 1 John 1, 9 and 10? If God does not want to forgive sins, if storms are for sinners only, why this teaching of Jesus Christ in the parable of the wise and the foolish builders that we have chosen as our text? Even if storms are for sinners only, who can stand God's judgment? Because if God keeps record of our sins, who can stand? Because for sure, we all are sinners saved by grace. And who are you then to judge another man's servant? People that the Son of Man has set free. Storms, my dear brothers and sisters, are realities of life and can strike anybody, anytime, anywhere, including believers. And this is why Jesus Christ made this statement in John 16:33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, you will have storms. But take heed, I have overcome the world. Praise the Lord. Storms will come, but be cheerful in them because Jesus Christ has overcome them for you. Just like He calmed the storm that struck His boat, so will He calm every storm in your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Christ never promised us a storm-free life. Not at all. But He promised us His peace, which guarantees our victory over every storm. The ultimate victory here is to make heaven at the end of everything. The peace promised is the presence of God, not absence of storms. This is succinctly written and captured in Psalm 23, verse 4. where David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear what? No evil, because God is with me. And in Isaiah 43:1-3, God made it very clear that even when you walk through fire, it will not burn you, because I am with you. This is the same piece St. Paul talked about in Philippians 4:4-7, and I quote, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice, no matter the storm. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation and circumstance and storm, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Therefore, in the face of storms, Jesus wants and expects us to put our trust in Him, not on worries, not on concerns, not on anxiety. When you do, victory will surely be yours. Do not put your trust on any man, because man's solution, if any, is temporal. No wonder the Bible in Jeremiah 17:5 says, cursed is the one who puts his trust in man, who draws strength from mere flesh, and whose heart turns away from the Lord. Another important lesson about life storms that I want to share with you is that it is only God that knows how the storm will end, how long it will last, and how it will end. What do I mean by this? Storms of life can be illness, opposition, loss of job, infertility, barrenness, bereavement, financial crisis, marital wahala, exam failures, disappointments, betrayals, unruly children, loss of contract or business opportunity or opportunities, visa denials, even deportation, poor academic performances, peer group pressures, pressures at work, and all the attempts at making you compromise your faith. It can be tests, trials, and even temptations. How long it will last and how it will end solely depends on God, depends on your relationship with Him and His overall plan for your life. No matter the form, shape, or color of the storm, the truth still remains that the only survivor antidote is Jesus Christ, and He alone knows the beginning and how it will end. Understanding this will give you the courage to weather your storm. So am I talking to somebody? I want to give some illustrations so that you don't get tossed about by some teachers from the pit of hell whose sole aim is to keep you under their control and perpetual bondage. Assume somebody's storm is illness, sickness. Depending on God's purpose for the life of such a person, any of these scenarios may play out. Scenario one, it could be a terminal sickness leading to death. This does not mean that God has disappointed anybody. If the person dies, it only means that the death of such a person fits best in the overall plan of God for the person. I want to tell you that God is the Alpha and Omega. So when we pray for a sick relation and God still calls the person home, do not feel betrayed or disappointed by God. Rather, behave like David in 2 Samuel 12:16-24. Therein is on record that when the son was sick, he fasted, he prayed, begged God to restore the son. But that was not God's plan. The child died. And the members of the family, they didn't know how to talk to them, because when the child was sick, David was in sackcloth. He didn't eat. He didn't talk to anybody. He was in seclusion. But when David saw them mingling around, he asked them, is the young man dead? They looked at each other and said, yes. And the Bible recorded that David got up, took his bath, and ate, and asked people, why are you? Then they asked him, what happened? When the child was sick, nobody could talk to you. You didn't eat. But now that the child is dead, you arose, took your bed, and made merry. He said, yes. The young man has gone. He cannot come back to me. But I will go to him. That should be our attitude. In circumstances where we have prayed and God decided to call the person home. Don't forget that it is this same God that saved Daniel from the lion's den. This same God saved Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego from the burning furnace. But this same God allowed John the Baptist to be beheaded. Allow Stephen to be stoned to death. Allow the early apostles to be martyred. It's also allowing some of our brothers and sisters in some parts of the world, including Nigeria, to be killed. When we are in Christ, to live is Christ and to die is gain. Philippians 1:21. Another scenario is that the sickness may last for a lifetime. You may just be on and off medications, but will live long enough to fulfill destiny and not be described as having died prematurely. The life of St. Paul exemplifies this. When you look at 2 Corinthians 12, 8 and 9, he was sick. He asked God for healing, but God said no. Rather, gave him grace that kept him moving. At the end of it all, it wasn't the sickness that killed Paul. Paul was beheaded. The storm may just be a test of your faith and just for a particular purpose. And I want to tell you that faithfulness in God, trust in God, and perseverance can only be learned in stormy, difficult times, not when life is sweet and rosy. And I want to say that it's also in difficult times that good, bad, and fair weather friends and relations are sealed. If not, you will not know those that actually love you. Ask Job, ask Abraham. Storms can be God's way to catch your attention. If we fail to learn the soft way, God may catch our attention through the hard way. Pharaoh refused to listen until the last plague, the death of every son. That's a hard way. That's storm. Finally, one can come out from storms unscathed, without any scratch, nothing. You may come out with scars, permanent ones or temporal ones. Let's use a scene of an automobile accident to illustrate this. Some may die instantly on the spot. Some may lose their limbs. Some may lose other parts of their bodies. Some may never walk again. While some may come out without any scratch. In all these storms, God is still in charge. No matter the storm and its attendant consequences, they are very temporal. Whether they last a lifetime or a few days or a few months or a few years, they cannot follow us to heaven, which is the ultimate goal. Romans 8:18, I consider that our present sufferings, our present storms, are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. This is confirmed also in 2 Corinthians 4:17, where the Bible says, for our light and momentary troubles, storms, are achieving in us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So no matter what the storm is, keep the fire of faith burning, knowing that a better glory awaits you in heaven and in eternity if you can weather these present storms. Of a truth, nobody wants the storms, but they are vital to us because God uses them not only to reveal himself to us, but to shape us to become more like Christ so that we can make heaven. According to Ephesians 4:14 and 15, my prayer for you is not to be tossed back and forth by the waves and storms and teachings of these fake people, and then blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful schemings, in the name of Jesus Christ. Let us build on the rock, which is Jesus Christ, so that when storms come, like this COVID-19 pandemic, our peace will not be troubled, knowing that the place of rest awaits us, where no storm exists. This hope should keep us in faith in the face of any storm, no matter how bad or how long it lasts, because God is forever faithful. Victory will surely be yours always. In Jesus' name, amen. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, we cannot shy away from the attack of the enemy. We know the ministry of the enemy is to kill, steal, and destroy, nothing else, and to accuse us before the mercy throne of God. But we have Jesus Christ. We have Jesus Christ, the author of life. Oh, the storm comer, there's nothing impossible with him. The Lord, Lord God of hosts, the mighty one in battle, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. I want to pray for you now. No matter the storm, no matter the name, no matter the shape of the storm, by the authority of the name of Jesus Christ, I speak peace into that situation in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive peace in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive healing in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive prosperity in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive wisdom and understanding in the name of Jesus Christ. All that you have lost, be it restored unto you in the name of Jesus Christ. Let there be felicity and fecundity in your life in the name of Jesus Christ. Barrenness cease in the name of Jesus Christ. Financial crisis cease in the name of Jesus Christ. Marital crisis sink in the name of Jesus Christ. Stagnancy and backwardness cease in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Heavenly Father. The storm of COVID-19 is over in the name of Jesus Christ. Nigeria will rise again. Nigeria will rise again in the name of Jesus Christ. I speak peace. I speak love. I speak joy. I speak wholeness to our church, our Savior Church TBS, and every member. Receive your peace. Let there be calm in your storm. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. And amen.